Hey, welcome everybody. You are listening to the Chad Blackman podcast, and I am your host, Chad Blackman. I am very excited about today's topic. We are going to wrestle with one of the most important, vital questions that a Christian could ever wrestle with. Not even Christians. This is a question that even skeptics or people who are somewhat on the fence must wrestle with. Why should we trust the Bible? The foundational document to all of Christianity. Is this book trustworthy? Can we really believe in it? Is there good, sound, intellectual reason to believe in this book? We're going to look at all of those different topics today. I'm excited to get into this. Thank you for joining me. Let's get after it. All right, so when it comes to Christianity, here's one thing that I have found. One of the major linchpins of Christianity, like if this thing fails, the whole thing fails, it's the reliability of the scriptures. The other major linchpin would be the resurrection of Christ. If these things can be disproven and you can shoot holes through them, then really the baby does get thrown out with the bathwater, because all of Christianity is based upon this collection of writings that we call the Bible. So how do we know that what we have written here is accurate, is trustworthy? Is there good, decent reason to believe the Bible is reliable? Or is this something that you kind of have to just take in blind faith and you've got to check your brain at the door? Joe Rogan is famous for asking all kinds of skeptical questions about the scriptures, trying to shoot down any kind of authority and trustworthiness that they might have. What I want to try to do today is give four reasons why we can trust the Bible, why you don't have to check your brain at the door, and why you can actually have good intellectual and academic reason to believe the Bible is truthful, is trustworthy, and actually points to being supernatural. We'll get to that at near the end. I want to show you really good reasoning, really good evidence why the Bible is unique and distinct amongst every other book in the world. And it seems like there's actually a hint of divinity to it, and we'll get there today. A lot of all of the stuff that we're going to talk about, we're going to kind of stay up at about 10,000 feet. You can really get down into the weeds when it comes to all of these different points. Today will just be sort of an overview, general picture of this, and then as we move forward, we can start drilling down in some of these points. There are scholars and pastors who have made their entire career trying to answer and really get down into the nitty-gritty with these things, but today will just be sort of a big picture kind of presentation. So let me give you four reasons why we can trust the Bible. In the very end, I'll give you a bonus reason that's maybe not super academic, more personal, but I'll throw it in there as well just for extra credit. So here's reason number one why we can trust the Bible, and it is the formation of the Bible. The Bible is not one book. It is 66 different books. It is 66 books written in three different languages: Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek. It was composed over 1,500 years in three different continents. So you have to consider here all the factors that are going on. You have multiple locations where scripture is being written. The Bible is very clear that mankind did not come up with scripture. There are many people who have said that the Bible is not a book man would write if he could and could write if he would. We have in 1 Timothy chapter 3, the very clear picture. It's actually 2 Timothy, if I'm not mistaken. One of the Timothys, I'm blanking on that now. I think it's 2 Timothy rather. 2 Timothy 3:16, that all scripture is breathed out by God. It's inspired by God. So what you have is three different continents over 1,500 years in three different languages, different socio-political events happening, different personal backgrounds people have. And what you'll see is that scripture has this consistent theme interwoven between it. It has this interoperability within it that is astounding. It really is hard to explain. How do we have such consistency and such a flow that goes between all of these different books of the Old Testament, right into the New Testament, all the way to the end of Revelation? How do all of these 66 books all tell one major story when they're written by so many different authors in different languages over different epochs of time in different continents? That is a really astounding fact to me. And there's lots of theories that are offered up to explain how that could happen. I think that the explanation that has the most explanatory power and is the most logical is that there was a greater mind that was communicating this truth to these human authors. I think that is what provides the consistency that we see through the Bible. Otherwise, what you have to do is invoke high levels of conspiracy and high levels of planning between these humans that would have never been possible. There would have been geographic barriers, language barriers. There were certain restraints that would have really prevented this common thread we see throughout all of the Bible, that there is a creator God who loves his people and is distinct from all the other gods of the world and is coming to rescue and is coming to save. I mean, you just see that theme through every single book of the Bible. And it's so vastly different than all the other religions of the world. How did that get into there over such time and different languages and different geographic regions? So the formation of the Bible to me is actually powerful evidence that there's a divine mind behind it, not just humans creating these ideas. And on that same thread, going into my next point here, the second reason why we can trust the Bible is because of prophecy. Now, this is something that it seems like a lot of academics and apologists try to steer away from. I don't hear this argument used very much, but this is very convincing to me. This is very powerful to me. The Bible makes predictions about the future, and those predictions have come true. You have to do something with that. You have to wrestle with that, especially when it comes to the Messiah. The Bible is very, very specific about how Jesus would show up, where he would show up, what his name would be called, the things that he would do, and specifically how he would be crucified on the cross. So I'll give you a couple of examples. Isaiah chapter 7 prophesies that there's going to be a virgin who gives birth to a son, and that son will have a very unique name, Emmanuel, God with us. Emmanuel's a normal name for us now, but that would have been a crazy thing to name a kid. To name your son God is with us, that's a very strange name. And yet Isaiah says this is going to come. Isaiah chapter 9, that same child in Isaiah 9 is then described as a son being given to the world. And this son is going to bear names that no other person has had. Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God, Everlasting Father, right? Those are titles of divinity that's going to be given to this child. And of course, we see in the life of Jesus, he was born of a virgin and he equated himself with God in John chapter 8 and various other texts through the Gospels. Even going further back into Genesis, God in Genesis chapter 3 tells Satan that there's coming an offspring through the line of Eve that will crush his head. He will bite this offspring's heel, which scholars say is picturesque of the nails going through Jesus' ankles. But then through that death of Christ on the cross, Christ crushes the head of the serpent. You have in Genesis chapter 12, God promising to Abraham that through Abraham's line is coming someone who all the nations of the world will be blessed by. That's a prophecy about the Messiah coming. And what you see now in our present day and age is that Christianity has transcended cultural boundaries, language boundaries, religious boundaries. It went from being this thing in first century Israel to now being in North America, South America, Asia, Africa, Europe. It is spread everywhere. And so we're seeing that prophecy come to fulfillment. I think for me personally, one of the most powerful prophecies is Isaiah 53. You could take Isaiah 53 and let like a seven-year-old read this. And even if they just had really shallow, like a cursory level of knowledge about who Jesus is, they'd read Isaiah 53 and go, that sounds like Jesus dying on the cross. Because what you'll see in Isaiah 53 are these very, very specific prophecies about the suffering servant, that he would be pierced for our transgressions. The chastisement that brings us peace would be placed onto him, that by his wounds we would be healed. He would be led to the slaughter like a sheep, and the way a lamb is silent before its shearers, he would be silent. So what we see is, like, when Jesus is put onto trial, he doesn't defend himself. He's silent before his defenders, or before his accusers, rather. We see Jesus being obviously nailed with those huge Roman spikes through his wrists, through his ankles, and fulfilling what Isaiah said, he would be pierced for our transgressions. We see that on the cross, Jesus is taking the wrath of God for our sins. The punishment that should have been put onto us is now put onto him. And it's through that exchange that we now have salvation. We now have peace. Even going into like Micah chapter 5. I mean, Micah 5 specifies that the Messiah is going to be born in Bethlehem. And of course, that's where we see Jesus being born in, even though his family is from a different city. There's these crazy circumstances that bring Jesus down to Bethlehem, and he's born in Bethlehem. I think one of the coolest gospels to read when it comes to this is the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew does a really good job throughout the whole gospel of pointing out every single prophecy that Jesus fulfilled. He does a really good job. Like, he did this to fulfill this prophecy, did this to fulfill this one. So I would encourage you to go check out the Gospel of Matthew, because you'll see, like, even the very beginning chapters, Matthew takes great detail to show Jesus comes perfectly from the line of Abraham through the line of David, takes great detail to show that he's fulfilled exactly the prophecies that would detail how the Messiah would come through the tribe of Judah, through the line of David. And it's just really cool to see that all play out. So, couple reasons we've covered so far. The formation of the Bible is pretty spectacular. How do you explain the consistency when it was written over 1500 years, three different continents, multiple languages? Seems like the best explanation is there's a divine mind behind it. Then you get to prophecy. How in the world is this book that was written over 1500 years, three different continents, three different languages, how did these different authors in different contexts make predictions about one person that's coming that were fulfilled with pinpoint accuracy? What's the best explanation for that? Did they just get incredibly, incredibly lucky? Or is there a divine mind behind this? When it comes to prophecy, one of the greatest objections you'll hear is that, well, these prophecies were made after the fact. And a lot of people said that about the book of Isaiah, because Isaiah 53 so specifically describes Christ. They were like, there's no way this could have been written beforehand. And so 1900s, a lot of German scholarship said that the book of Isaiah had to be written after the life of Christ. That whole theory got blown to shreds. I mean, got exploded when a little Bedouin shepherd threw a rock into the caves in Qumran, and then the Dead Sea Scrolls were found. And the Dead Sea Scrolls are hard academic evidence that show the book of Isaiah had to be have written at least 150 years before the arrival of Christ. Most scholars are going to put Isaiah being written about 700 years before the arrival of Christ. And yet you have these surgical predictions about what Messiah would do, the names he would be given, the way in which he would die. And man, he died in a way that wasn't even practiced at the time. Isaiah is writing about a manner of death that wasn't even done when he wrote about it. And yet he just so specifically nails it. It's not nothing. You have to do something with prophecy. So, Bible formation, prophecy. Let's go here now to the third reason, the manuscript evidence. Okay, what in the world do I mean by manuscript evidence? What I mean is that when it comes to the Bible has more manuscripts. And another word for that is just copies. We have copies of the Bible. I want to be clear, we don't have the original writings. Like, we don't have the very first, you know, first edition, like straight from the hand of Paul or Peter. We don't have those. It's probably good we don't have those, because we'd probably worship them or treat them in ways that are not correct. What we do have are copies of those originals. And we have copies, especially when it comes to the New Testament, that are within about 40 to 50 years of the original writings, and some, I mean, 50 to 60 years within the life of Christ. How many of these copies do you ask? How many of these copies do we have? Well, we have roughly 6,000 copies of the New Testament alone. That doesn't include everything that we have from the Old Testament. There's even more from the Old Testament that we can add to that number. We have manuscripts that are in Greek, that are in Coptic, that are in Latin, that are in Syriac. We have thousands and thousands and thousands of these manuscripts. There is no other religious text or secular historical text that has the manuscript evidence and attestation that the Bible has. There's none that's even close. There's not even a close second place. Couple of examples, like the writings of Julius Caesar's, his Gallic Wars. We have about 10 to 15 manuscripts, depending on who you ask. And the closest manuscript we have to his original writings is 1,000 years after the original. By comparison, the New Testament, over 6,000 within about 60 years of the life of Christ. So the abundance of the manuscripts and the proximity to the original writings is unparalleled in any form of literature that we have today. Here's why this is so important. Here's where this gets really, really important. I call this answering the Joe Rogan question. Joe Rogan constantly brings up the Bible has been translated into so many different languages over so many years in so many different contexts. Surely what we have now is not what was written back in the original times. And the beautiful answer that we can give as Christians is that we have hard literary academic evidence to show through an abundance of manuscripts that what we have today, the Bible that we have today, matches almost with surgical pinpoint precision what was originally written. Now, I said almost. Why did I say almost? Because we do see some changes that go throughout the ages. Here's what we'll see. I'll tell you the changes that we find. There's about a 98 to 99%, once again, it depends who you ask, 98 to 99% accuracy amongst the manuscripts. The differences that we'll see are changes in punctuation, some changes in spelling, and a couple of like short term, like they'll abbreviate some names instead of writing out names long term, like long form. There is no major change in doctrine, no major change in what Christ said, in what the apostles taught, the miracles that were recorded, and especially no contradiction or change when it comes to the resurrection of Christ. So what we have is hard academic evidence that can show all the way to the first century. We have manuscripts all the way from the first century. The unparalleled consistency from the first century all the way now to us in the 21st century, that the Word of God has stayed remarkably the same. It has not changed. The problem people have with translation is they oftentimes think of it like the game telephone. They'll think of it like when you play that game telephone, you whisper something to your neighbor, and then they whisper it, and they whisper it, and they whisper it, and it goes around the room. And inevitably, by the time it gets to the end, the message has completely changed. And that's what people think has happened with the Bible, that the message has completely changed. What we can show is that throughout every single century, we can show that, look, what they were saying in the 14th century is exactly what they were saying in the 12th. And what they're saying in the 12th is exactly what they were saying in the 10th. And on, all the way back to the first century. And that, to me, is such great news. That's so affirming and so confidence-building in my soul to trust the Scriptures. This book really has not altered and been changed over the years. There's this crazy verse in the Bible. The Scriptures say heaven and earth is going to pass away, but the Word of God will not pass away. It really does seem like this book has been supernaturally protected and preserved, because, I mean, every other idea does say, like, this book should have changed over all the translations and all the different geographic areas it's been. It looks like it should have been fundamentally altered. And it really hasn't been. It's been miraculously protected, and we have thousands and thousands of manuscripts to prove it. So I just think that's pretty cool. All right, here's the ground we've covered. Bible formation, 1,500 years, three continents, three different languages, one common theme. How do you explain that? Throughout the Bible formation, we have very precise prophecies about the Messiah. How do you explain the prophecies? How do you explain such accuracy? Then we have hard, solid evidence, manuscript evidence that shows the Bible has not been altered. The Bible has not in any substantial way been changed or corrupted or perverted from all of the different translations. Here's the fourth reason why we can believe in the Scriptures: the archaeological evidence. The archaeological evidence of especially the land of Israel gives such credence to what was written in the Scriptures. All throughout the land of Israel right now, they are finding archaeological discovery after archaeological discovery that coincides with exactly what was written in the Scriptures. I'll give you a couple just off the top of my head. The Tel Dan inscription that was found in the northern part of Israel. The Tel Dan inscription specifically names the House of David. It refers to the House of David, which is referring to the royal kingdom of King David. Hezekiah's tunnel. I've had the privilege of walking through Hezekiah's tunnel twice. You can go to Israel today and walk through this tunnel that King Hezekiah carved out as the enemies were besieging Jerusalem, as they were trying to choke and starve out Jerusalem. Hezekiah figured out this way to divert water into the city of Jerusalem to help keep his city alive. And that's all recorded in the book of Kings and in Chronicles. And you can go see the archaeological evidence that coincides with those scriptural verses. One of the things I'll share with you that I just found was so cool. I was listening to Dr. John Bergsma on Pints with Aquinas, great podcast if you haven't checked that out. And he was detailing this, what happened at this conference he went to. There was a guy named Stephen Collins who they discovered in kind of the Jordanian desert area near the Dead Sea, near Israel. They found the remains of two giant city mounds. And what Dr. John Bergsma was immediately cued into was, did you find any weapons in this area? Did you find any arrowheads? Did you find any fragments of shields or swords or anything like that? Which would indicate that these two cities were sacked in war. And they didn't find anything like that. And instead, what Stephen Collins starts to articulate and starts to spell out, they found pottery remains all throughout these old two city mounds. And they originally thought that the site was contaminated, that other artifacts had been brought in there, because what they started to find was on one side of the pottery, there was something called trinitite. It's this crystalline formation that happens in the sand from atomic blasts. So when they were testing the bombs out in the desert, the sand would like turn into this crystalline formation. And they were finding this on one side of the pottery that was left in these city remains. And they were like, what is this doing here? This shouldn't be here. It doesn't fit with the time period that we suspect these cities were originally from. And so as they start to dig through this, they're finding that this crystalline material is only on one side of the pottery. They're also starting to find half remains of humans. They're finding only half remains, and these humans and also the crystalline formations on this pottery were being formed at like a 25 degree angle coming down from the sky. And what he said was that there was some kind of unparalleled heat event that came down from the sky, created this crystalline material on these pieces of pottery, and incinerated half portions of humans in these twin cities. Now, if you know your Bible at all, that reads almost identically to what is recorded in Genesis chapter 19 in Sodom and Gomorrah, where God rains down fire from heaven on these two rebellious cities. And so these are just a couple of examples of archaeological finds that correspond so strikingly close to what the Bible has already detailed. And it's cool for me. It gives me legitimate confidence to trust in the Word of God. I don't have to check my brain at the door. I can actually really believe in this. There's good evidence to believe in it. Now, with all of that being said, those are four reasons, and I think those are reasons that would hold up fairly well trying to dialogue with a skeptic or someone that doesn't really believe this yet. This last bonus one I want to give you is kind of more for the believer or more for someone who actually is seeking. And I just call this the subjective argument. This is the personal argument. And I'll say it like this. Jesus made this statement that wisdom will be proved right by her children. And what he means by that is that over time, wisdom shows itself to be true. Wisdom shows itself to be better than the foolishness and the ideas of the world. That it takes a little bit of time to kind of see how God's ways lead to life. They lead to blessing. They lead to goodness. Whereas the best ideas and the best philosophies of the world often end up in dead ends. They don't go anywhere. And so the subjective argument today that I want to give to you is just the kind of the life-changing nature that the Bible had on me. That as I started to read the Word of God, I started to see a wisdom here in these words that I didn't find anywhere else. Even when it comes to great philosophers and great other religious figures, I saw something, for example, in the book of Proverbs that I didn't see in those other great philosophers, especially in the writings and the teachings of Jesus. I saw a depth and a teaching that pierced through the facade of intelligence and pierced through the facade of morality and got right down to the heart that I never really saw anywhere else. And as I started to think on these teachings and read about them, and it didn't immediately like change me. It wasn't like this overnight, all of a sudden I was different. But over time, I started to see that these writings and the truth that's in this book is powerful, and it started to change my own life and my own heart. And what I always want to encourage people to do is read the Bible, and even if you feel like you're not understanding it, because I'll be honest, there's a lot of stuff in there that's hard to understand. Reading the scriptures is, man, it just changes you over time. It's kind of like just faithfully working out, faithfully going to the gym. Like you may not feel like you're making huge gains in the moment and feel like you're, bulking up and crushing it in the moment, but that faithful returning to the gym over and over, what it does is it over time it does change you. It does strengthen you. And I've found that to be true when it comes to the Bible. that over time it just sort of started to change how I thought and change how I saw things. And I'll say it like this. The Bible describes itself as being living and active. It's sharper than a double-edged sword. It pierces through bone and marrow, and it gets down to the deep parts of who we are. And what I have felt is that oftentimes as I'm reading the Bible, it feels like the Bible is reading me back. It's almost like the Bible knows what's going on in my life, and it's like it's speaking back to me. And that's a total subjective, that's a total personal experience. I'm aware of that. But I didn't want to let it go unspoken. I didn't want to not bring that up. Because to me, one of the greatest encouragements I have for people is, hey man, if you read this book, dude, it'll change you. Like, this book will absolutely, it'll speak, it'll cut down to the deepest parts of who you are, because it promises to do that. Because I'm convinced, and I think the evidence shows it, that this isn't a book that was created by humans. This is not something we tried to come up with. Because this book, I mean, if you read it, it doesn't paint us in a very good light. Like, we're the ones that are screwing everything up in this book. It seems to me, though, this really is a divine communication from the mind of God to us about what we need to know about God and what we need to know about salvation and what we need to know about our purpose while we're here. The way I want to wrap this all up is to just commend you to let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. That's what Colossians 3 calls us to do. Let this book saturate and seep and soak through you. And if you don't have any kind of habit or discipline into reading the word yet, I want to call you to start that. I want to call you to start practicing that. The two places I always recommend to begin, the book of Proverbs, I think, is an awesome place to start reading. It's simple and it's profound all at the same time. Easy to grab, and yet you'll see some really deep wisdom in there. And then the Gospel of John, I think, is a beautiful gospel to start, to know who Jesus is, to know what he's about, and to start going from there. So my hope is that this gives you some tools, some ammunition. Maybe this gives you some more confidence. Maybe this answers some questions that you had when it comes to the Bible. I really do believe that if we can't defend the Bible, we can't defend anything else in Christianity. This is like frontline important stuff. And I'm convinced that the Bible has real good reasons to believe in it. So hopefully you found that as well. I hope that this encouraged you. And I just want to thank you again. Thank you for checking this out. I'll see you on the next podcast. All right. That's all I got. Bye.